Paltrocast.
Good morning for you so far, besides talking to press.
Good morning. So it's Darren with a D, right?
Darren with a D. Sam right. With an S, right? SJJ. There you go. Thank you for taking the time. And we were set up to talk about An Unlikely Angel. I've got other questions to ask, but when did you actually film An Unlikely Angel?
Oh, my goodness. Oh, wow. Yeah. Good question. No, my goodness. I'm sorry. I've been working so much. It's been such a huge blessing. Oh, it had to be December. It had to be December of last year. Yes. We were in Lynchburg, Virginia. It was wonderful.
That was going to be my next question. Where was it actually filmed? Because the majority of films, if they present a city landscape, usually they're not telling you where they were filmed. You find out it was Utah, North Carolina, Louisiana, something like that. So was this your first time filming in this part of Virginia?
Gosh, I've been doing this 45 years. Let me just think. Yeah. Well, I've been to Virginia many times, but I do believe it's the first time filming in the Lynchburg area, which is beautiful, by the way.
When did you start to notice that films are not primarily filming in New York and Los Angeles anymore?
Well, that happened years ago. I think when a lot of filmmakers started using wisdom and saying, wait a minute, there's great incentives in other states, other places of America. And obviously those states are opened up. I mean, now it's Georgia, obviously, Virginia. Yep. And it works perfect. And it's good for, it's cost effective as well. And you can pretty much get the same results.
Yeah, but you used to have to move to these places to make it, New York or LA, or you couldn't have a career. Now you can live anywhere you want as long as you're available for the filming. So would you say that started about 15 years ago, 10 years ago?
Yeah. Oh, no. Yeah. Longer. I've traveled really. I think I'm trying to the majority of my films. Yeah, probably was L.A., but maybe 40% were far off places overseas as well. And then a lot. I mean, one of my series, we did the Highwayman. We did that in Arizona. And we're talking 1988. Mm-hmm. So that's quite a few. Yeah, that's 88 is quite a few years.
Yeah, it is, in a good way, though, because when you think about 1988, you get great albums by Whitesnake and all that, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about you and your greatness and all that. But Unlikely and An Unlikely Angel, did you know that it was going to be coming out through PureFlix when you signed up for it?
Tell you the truth, it was mentioned. PureFlix was mentioned. I'm not sure. Because, I really had nothing to do with as a producer. They brought me in as an actor. But mm-hmm. I believe that PureFlix was mentioned at the beginning, just over conversation. But no, it was a nice surprise that they came through and committed, and it's wonderful. I mean, it's my first project with PureFlix involved. And releasing it and doing the campaign and all of that.
So it sounds like, as an outsider, you got the script, you went, I'll do it. You trusted the people, the end result, and here you are doing the media coverage and the press.
Yeah, no, it's wonderful. And it's I played the dad quite a few times. Mm-hmm. Now I also got to play the grandfather. So it was my first grandfather part. And I had to. I mean, the script is... Rebecca wrote it and mm-hmm. Darrell directed it, and other than faith-based, which it is, it also has these incredible, surprising, kind of shocking twists, and it takes us for a ride. Mm-hmm. I believe without giving away any spoilers, obviously there's divine intervention,
right?
But as we watch it, we're going to self-evaluate our own lives, trying to manage. We all have to work. We all have to work. Okay, well, what happens if we have young children involved, mm-hmm. Is it just going to be, okay, I'm going to spend a little time with them, or are we going to actually try to turn it into quality time. And this is something we all go through in life. And I believe it's revealed in a really incredible way, again, with some twist on how do we manage that, especially how do we prioritize all that with all the busyness? Mm-hmm. And some of that, some of the busyness is priority, but a lot of times I think we just, it's self-induced. You know, we got to be busy for busy sake. And that is addressed big time.
It's cool to see that you can do a project like this, yet also the roles that you did in the Ted movies,
yeah,
hilarious, brought laughter to millions upon millions of people. When you yell out at your nemesis in the first Ted movie, a lot of people went, whoa, this guy can do comedy.
Yeah.
Was there any hesitation on your end to taking the Ted role, the first one?
No, well, when Seth MacFarlane called me and he described the script to me, and then when I received the script and I read it, I called him back. I said, well, Seth, it's, you know, I mean, it, yes, this, I understand you've hired me to play myself, to sort of make fun of myself and as Flash Gordon. I think that's cool. But yeah, did I party in the 80s? Yes. Is this me, really me? I said, it's now, it's parts and pieces of me. So there were a couple pages of dialogue where we had to really go back and forth with and do a couple edits and deletes, which I'm grateful for.
I'm glad to hear that he was open to collaboration on that end. A lot of producers or writers go, the script is the script, take it or leave it.
Yeah. But
you don't always hear about Seth MacFarlane and team being open. So yeah. Did you make it funnier or you made it more serious and more about you?
That's a great question. Comedy is a funny thing. I think the more we play at it, then the less funny it's going to be. Flash Gordon, and I still have a little bit of Flash Gordon, that is the strong naivete, very naive. And that had something to do with me actually getting the part. Mm-hmm. And I think with Ted, carrying that over a little bit, but obviously when Ted came along, I'd already been in the business almost 40 years, over 30, what, Ted 1 was, my goodness.
More than 2 years.
Yes, it was 10 years ago, right? Ted 1, my goodness, something like that.
Yeah.
So 35 years already in the business. So don't like to use the term have been tainted a little bit after all those years in the business. But we need to hang on to, you know, our God-given ethics and skill sets and talents. I love when you throw the label inaugural or first time. Well, this was Seth's directorial debut. And there's something about it. I just love being part of first time events, inaugurals. And when he called me and said that Universal Studios really have given him a green light to do what he wants to do. I mean, I knew he was very successful. I had no idea even then. The three animated shows, Family Guy and Cleveland Show and American Dad, was and is a $1 billion franchise.
Yeah.
I didn't know animated shows to become that. Yeah.
The Simpsons and South Park really opened up the gate for shows that could last more than 8 years from the animated world. So credit to Seth. I think he knows what he's doing at this point, but this is the cheerleading for Sam Jones interview. Mm-hmm. So the last thing that I want to know before I let you go is I have a dual existence where I interview people, but I work as an investigator. And when I read about your security professional work, wow, okay. Are you still doing that or acting, you know, got fast?
Yeah, but I love your vernacular. I love your terminology. And I'm gonna steal that. Dual existence. I love that. I don't remember ever hearing that, but yes, a dual existence. And my wife was very encouraging 22 years ago when the phone wasn't ringing. And this is really good. I don't, my wife normally gives advice to the women and I do for the men, but anytime the wives ask me, well, what advice do you have to give me? I said, I usually say, before you give your husband a really strong, bold reprimand, build him up a little bit. So, so she told me one day, 22 years ago, she said, honey, you know, you're a talented actor, but I've been watching you wait by the phone for 8 months. It's not ringing. We have, at that time, we have two kids in diapers, one just out of diapers. Mm-hmm. There's the door. Come back to this family when you're providing for this family. And thank God she said that. Because, we, you know, as men anyway, we could, again, self-induce everything. And we can walk in our own muck and mire. Usually comes about from our own wrong choices. Hmm. And making the same choices over and over again, expecting a different end result, which is insanity, by the way. Okay. Right. We have to change our choices if we want a different outcome. So I connect with some of my former Marine Corps buddies doing PSDs, personal security details, operations around the world, primarily Mexico, running mm-hmm. security operations cross-border into Mexico. I got retrained up. I got my certifications and I got this other vocation, dual existence. And started running team, relocated to San Diego from LA and crossed the border daily. I took a couple force protection teams to the Southern Philippines. And guess what happened after about a year and a half of 2 years of doing that? The phone started to ring to do more movies. Isn't that fascinating how that works? Yeah. But men, we really have to listen to the people we trust. And if we're married, it's going to be our wives. And it not only saved my marriage, it now, if the film industry is slow, I could run security operations and vice versa. So dual existence, as you say.
It's interesting to see how many of the people who found success within the security world were professional athletes, professional actors, and it's a reinvention thing, whether or not they come into it. Like a lot of professional wrestlers became security people, and you go, well, duh. They can fend for themselves and at the same time portray a character that says, yeah, you better listen to me. So well, in your case.
Yeah, but that's it. You said certain actors became security professionals. And I thought, and I've been thinking about that. I can't name too many of them because you see, it puts us in a unique position. When you hire me to make your movie as an actor, I come on the set. Now I can hire myself to protect myself. I don't know of a whole lot of actors becoming, you know, running personal security details around the world.
Around the world, I'm not aware of. I'm aware of law enforcement, like the 60s pop singer Bobby Sherman.
Wow, really?
A top cop and behind the scenes
person. I didn't know it. And Bobby Sherman was a big name, right? He was.
And all the money that he makes goes to charity. So that's every wonderful. Now and then the people are out there. I mean, my favorite bizarre one before I let you go is Jeff Skunk Baxter from the Doobie Brothers. Do you know about him?
No. Give me the name again.
Jeff Skunk Baxter. He played guitar for Steely Dan and the Doobie Brothers. And
the Doobie Brothers. Yeah. Oh my gosh. I used to. Well, famous. What's the biggest famous song that we used to sing and hum to back in the... Was that the early 70s or late 60s?
Doobie Brothers, I would say mid-70s.
Mid-70s, yeah, okay, yeah. Because the first album I ever bought was Creedence Clearwater Revival. That would have been the late 60s.
Yes.
And then Doobie Brothers, what a great riff, the tune that just stuck in our heads forever.
Agreed, but...
Doobie Brothers, yeah. So he became what? Law enforcement?
He consults for the government about ways to possibly combat terrorism.
I love it.
He wrote a paper about how the turntable was just seen as a record player, but actually was used to create music. So I think somebody at the government said, well, then that means that you could determine what might be weapons that we don't think are weapons.
Wow. So
he's turned out to do much better in government consulting and military consulting than in music. So
I want you to send me that link. I want you to send me that article, that link, that book. Will you do that, please?
I will do that, Sam. But in the meantime, thank you for your time. Thank you for the years of great entertainment. Looking forward to whatever's coming next from you.
Yeah. Unlikely Angel on Pure Flix.
Paltrocast.